When I took on this show, I knew that certain issues needed to be discussed right up front. And top of the list was 9/11, because no event has affected our world, especially the Middle East, more than 9/11. But all the major players in this event have received obvious cover from the governments, academics, and of course, the mainstream media. Aside from the sycophants protecting their masters, there is a much more insidious enemy of truth known as political correctness. I will not bow to such manipulations. Political correctness is a trap, functioning as a tool to prevent honest dialogue. It fosters, if not compels, self-censorship. It is a blatant form of thought control. So when I use the word Jew instead of Zionist, for example, I do so because it is the most accurate word to describe those whose primary allegiance is to the Jewish state of Israel. To use the word Zionist, as the thought police would have of me, would deny the fact that Israel is the Jewish state, not the Zionist state. Take the Christian Zionists, which are some of Israel's staunchest supporters. They're not granted the same right of settlement as their Jewish counterparts. Why? Well, because they're Zionists, but they are not Jewish. In the end, nobody is better placed to stop the criminality of the Jewish state than Jews themselves.
Go back to where you came from.
Every single day,
for the
speedy and peaceful dismantlement of the state of Israel. Then we can once again coexist as we have for hundreds of years. We have all the rabbis who will testify lived in the old state of Jerusalem. In the old state, in the old city of Jerusalem. In the old city, they lived door by door. This rabbi lived in the old city of Jerusalem. Before 1948, he'll tell you how he lived, coexisted with all the Arab neighbors, how they babysat each other's children when they went to Yom Kippur, when the women went to Yom Kippur on the fast day, the Muslim neighbors babysat the children, the most precious objects they gave to them to protect.
Whether we like it or not, taking responsibility for the actions of our governments that operate in our name, that receive our complicity and our support, is essential to solving the problems we face. Blame shifting, on the other hand, is tantamount to voluntary maintenance of the tyranny. As for my motivations, I consider every single human being to be a brother or sister in one human family. And I want what is best for every member of my family. And I mean every member. But patronizing talk and false sensitivity helps nobody. Let there be no mistake. My greatest scorn is reserved for my birth nation of the United States, that is without doubt the greatest terrorist entity of the 20th and 21st centuries, regardless of the fact that it has been hijacked by traitors and foreign agents. So if the citizens of the Jewish state and the United States want to avoid the virtually inevitable retribution coming their way, it will be by changing their disastrous course without delay. In this sense, I am all too ironically a friend to the Jewish state and the American people, because both must face their criminal nature while they still have a chance. And to make this point that much clearer, if the situation were reversed and the Jewish people were being broadly blamed for the crimes of 9/11 when clearly they were patsies, I would be the first to stand up in their defense. Let me also extend an open invitation to Israeli, British, and American government representatives so as to challenge me on any point I make in this program or future programs, with a special invitation to Israeli spokesperson Mark Regev, who I will devote an entire program to one-on-one debate if he has the courage to take me up on it. If, however, these governments and their trolls simply choose to sling mud, you can rest assured it is because they are cowardly propagandists who could never back up their insultingly false incantations outside of the cozy confines of the whorehouses they frequent, otherwise known as the mass media. Before we explore the truth regarding 9/11, I must thank Christopher Bolin, Mark Glenn, Jonathan Azazia, Mark Dankoff, and Xander Z. Fereza for reviewing the content of this program. They have provided invaluable input. Now, the first thing to discuss about 9/11 is the fact that this event is quite possibly the greatest mind control event in human history. Certain aspects of it are so stark, so profound, that within this historic event can be seen a tremendous gift. But firstly, let me acknowledge the obvious. While my birth nation of America has meted out more violence in the 20th and 21st century than any other entity, it does not change the fact that the events of 9/11 are a great tragedy, not only for what happened on the day, but also for the far, far greater suffering and death that has resulted from it. Having said that, The gift lies in 9/11 serving as a litmus test for humanity. Indeed, I will make the case that we have reached a flashpoint in human history that will decide the fate of all life on planet Earth, because in the nuclear age, we simply cannot sustain the collective insanity of our current path. We have come this close to nuclear annihilation many times over, and facing the truth about 9/11 can be the beginning of the end of that insanity. The good news is that poll after poll makes very clear that more and more people do not trust the official account of 9/11. Around the world, it is safe to say that the majority of people do not accept the official version of the event. In America itself, roughly half doubt or disbelieve the official version altogether. And herein lies the heart of the gift. Despite all of the mass media deception, people are seeing straight through the lies and regaining the capacity to think and process information intelligently. This is absolutely critical in the process of liberating humanity from the bondage and ignorance and division. I have often used a metaphor to describe the current state of human existence, and it goes like this. Human society has created and ultimately consented to the institutions of power that oppress us, to such a degree that we the people have constructed a massive prison that every man, woman, and child, for the most part, have voluntarily entered. We have then closed the prison door behind us, taken the key within our collective hands and locked the prison door. As if this wasn't bad enough, incredibly, we have then handed the key to the prison door to a group of psychopathic tyrants who have all too wisely remained outside of the prison. Subsequently, we continue to beg these tyrants for the crumbs while we continue to remain locked in a prison of our own making. Now, the prison is a metaphor for our current financial system, a financial system utilized by the tyrants to control virtually every aspect of human existence. And yet, and please listen to what I am saying here, the tyrants are powerless without our consent. And while we have collectively entered this prison, we can tear down the prison walls of financial enslavement in an instant. No matter what our religion, non-religion, what color we are, what country we come from, what group we relate to, or what philosophy we subscribe to, we, the masses, have the same cause. We want the same things. We want to live a dignified life. We want a just and peaceful world. The powers that be know this very well, and that is why they must continuously divide us and rule us. The key to the maintenance of their tyranny is hoodwinking us into fighting each other for the crumbs from their lavish tables. And believe me, the powers that be revel in the madness that is our division and ultimately self-imposed enslavement. They are laughing at us. They mock us. But it doesn't have to be this way. Do you want a better world, a sane, just, and peaceful world? Well, so do I. In fact, I demand such a world because I refuse to accept the unacceptable. And while I hold the tyrants responsible for ungodly amounts of suffering and injustice and death, I cannot ignore the fact that they could not possibly have achieved this without the massive compliance from the masses, from us. Which brings us back to an uncomfortable truth, which is that we are guilty to one degree or another. I want to issue a huge apology to a group to which I am not a member. Because as I will lay out very clearly, if there is one group that cannot be held responsible for the 9/11 event, it is the very group blamed for this crime. And that would be the Muslims around the world. So let me say with resounding clarity on behalf of all sane, thinking people, we are deeply sorry that Muslims have been falsely accused of the events of 9/11 and that subsequently, countless Muslim lands and people have endured the farcical war on terror. We apologize for the invasions, occupations, drone strikes, torture, Guantanamo, for all of the maiming and the death that has rained down on you. Let it be understood from this day forward, from this non-Muslim, that we know the 9/11 false flag was intentionally, falsely blamed on you so as to cultivate a clash of civilizations. We reject the war on terror in total and shall identify those responsible come hell or high water. When we return, we shall discuss the absurdity of the official version of 9/11, and more importantly, whose fingerprints are left all over this event. The official version of 9/11 is a terribly bad B-movie. It is a massive insult to our intelligence and all too significantly reveals the depth of mind control that many in our world are subject to. All too ironically, those of us who are not so brain dead as to believe the official version are called conspiracy theorists. Despite the obvious fact that the official version of 9/11 is in fact, you guessed it, a conspiracy. It just so happens to be the most ridiculous conspiracy of them all. And let us not forget these important facts. Osama bin Laden himself denied any involvement in 9/11. And before you have that knee-jerk reaction of saying he confessed to it on video, hold that thought. With regard to America's supposed need to invade Afghanistan in pursuit of bin Laden, the Taliban stated on record that they would extradite him if only the United States would adhere to this paltry little thing called due process of law, which also involves another little thing called evidence. As it turns out, the U.S. decided in favor of invading and occupying two nations and turning them back to the Stone Age. As far as the evidence is concerned, it's a sort of don't worry about it kind of thing, so bin Laden was never actually charged with any crime regarding 9/11. With the FBI stating in 2006 that there was, quote, no hard evidence linking bin Laden to 9/11. Going back to the supposed bin Laden video confession, if the FBI does not believe it, why do you? As for the supposed 19 hijackers, there is no video evidence of any of the hijackers boarding the planes, from airports controlled by Israeli security no less. Several items have been used as evidence to implicate these patsies, but these are ridiculous. As already mentioned, three passports belonging to alleged hijackers were supposedly recovered. In the case of Saddam al-Sakami's passport, it is said to have survived the plane crash's explosive fireball in the North Tower, falling hundreds of feet to the ground and then randomly picked up by a passerby who delivered it to the New York Police Department. In pristine condition, no less, with no burns, tears, or rips, with the picture and name perfectly visible. Once again, no bodies or plane wreckage was recovered from the alleged Flight 93 crash site in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, supposedly because the plane crashed at such an incredible rate of speed that apparently everything vaporized. Nonetheless, two passports, a martyrdom note, and a red bandana that is said to have been worn by one of the hijackers was remarkably recovered.
On the morning of September 11th, 2001, 19 men armed with box cutters directed by a man on dialysis in a cave fortress halfway around the world using a satellite phone and a laptop directed the most sophisticated penetration of the most heavily defended airspace in the world, overpowering the passengers and the military combat trained pilots on four commercial aircraft before flying those planes wildly off course for over an hour without being molested by a single fighter interceptor. These 19 hijackers, devout religious fundamentalists who like to drink alcohol, snort cocaine, and live with pink-haired strippers, managed to knock down three buildings with two planes in New York. While in Washington, a pilot who couldn't handle a single-engine Cessna was able to fly a 757 in an 8,000-foot descending 270-degree corkscrew turn to come exactly level with the ground, hitting the Pentagon in the budget analyst office where DOD staffers were working on the mystery of the $2.3 trillion that Defense Secretary Donald Rumsfeld had announced missing from the Pentagon's coffers in a press conference the day before, on September 10th, 2001. Luckily, the news anchors knew who did it within minutes.
Osama bin Laden.
The pundits knew within hours.
Osama bin Laden.
The administration knew within the day.
Terrorists who committed these acts and those who harbor them.
And the evidence literally fell into the FBI's lap.
That a hijacker's passport was found blocks from the World Trade Center crash site, if you can believe that.
But for some reason, a bunch of crazy conspiracy theorists demanded an investigation into the greatest attack on American soil in history. That investigation was delayed, underfunded, set up to fail, a conflict of interest, and a cover-up from start to finish. It was based on testimony extracted through torture, the records of which were destroyed. It failed to mention the existence of WTC-7, Able Danger, PTEC, Sibel Edmonds, OBL and the CIA, and the drills of hijacked aircraft being flown into buildings that were being simulated at the precise same time that those events were actually happening. It was lied to by the Pentagon, the CIA, the Bush administration. And as for Bush and Cheney, well, no one knows what they told it because they testified in secret, off the record, not under oath, and behind closed doors. It didn't bother to look at who funded the attacks because that question is ultimately of little practical significance.